of that yesterday, which is only 1991. So if you take yesterday as 1991, the entire yesterday, today, tomorrow changes your paradigm. If you take yesterday as 1950, your paradigm changes. And if you take your yesterday from 1975, your paradigm changes. And so many violent and explosive political debates took place in 1975. And Lal Mission Party and Comrade Yashwant Sarwan were party to it. And nobody in 1975 thought, nobody in 1975 ever thought that time will come that the ideology in which Comrade Jawan and many people here believe would completely disintegrate in the manifestation of collapse of Soviet Union in 1991. Nobody thought. Nobody could have imagined the collapse of Soviet Union even up to 1989 when the Berlin Wall came down. Even at that time there were people who thought that the Soviet Union will survive despite the collapse of Eastern Europe. But it did not. In just 2 years after that, Soviet Union got disintegrated, collapsed, and entire Eastern Europe and Soviet Union, the red flag had gone. Is it not interesting to see that the same year when Soviet Union got disintegrated, the same year began the splintering of or the Balkanization of Yugoslavia itself. Yugoslavia was Balkans, and now Yugoslavia's Balkanization began in 1991 and concluded only a few years ago with Kosovo getting separate. Something like 7 republics have born out of Yugoslavia. And that process also began in 1991, the same year when Soviet Union disappeared and entire Eastern Europe had gone. The ideology that was a hallmark of character and belief and faith and movement and strength of Comrade Y.V. Chavan was suffering setback across the world. And let us not pretend that the same red flag which came in 1949 in China continues to hold sway today in China. In 1989, the same year the Berlin Wall came down, it was the Tiananmen Square massacre which attacked students, the Chinese Communist Party. And there were enough communists here in India who defended the attack on the students in Tiananmen Square, saying that if there is going to be an attack on the communist state, well, you have to face the consequences. But in 1991, just 2 years after that, the year which I mentioned about Soviet Union's disappearance and Yugoslavia splintering, the same year, even Chinese decided that 1989 so-called revolt could be fought back only by one thing, and that was liberalization of economy. So though technically in 1978 when Deng Xiaoping took over had started liberalization, he actually began to aggressively implement only in 1991, the same year Soviet Union disappeared, Rajiv Gandhi was killed, and America invaded Iraq and liberated Kuwait. And we perhaps not easily remember, perhaps Nandan is actually a professional in that. It is the same year when the internet revolution began, which has changed our life completely. Rajiv Gandhi could not Google. Rajiv Gandhi could not have sent the messages like we send on SMS. Rajiv Gandhi himself, a man who is supposed to be an harbinger of computer revolution or software revolution or technological revolution in India, himself did not have access till he died to the modern computer facilities, and no question of iPods and iPads and Kindles and so on. Rajiv Gandhi died before that. He had just begun to teach his cabinet ministers as to how to use computer for our internal functioning. So that also is the year 1991 when Rajiv Gandhi went from us. So 1991 cuts off at everything that we live today. And therefore, while talking about yesterday, today and tomorrow, I wonder exactly which yesterday is actually relevant today comprehensively, completely. Which yesterday is completely relevant? I don't think any specific yesterday can be referred to, but all yesterdays put together have a direct bearing on what type of life we are living today or likely to live in next 10 years or perhaps later. So I personally feel that when we talk of yesterday, we cannot ignore the changing nature of ideologies, and I'm sure Ram, having studied Marx, and Madhav, of course, with me, lived with Marxian movements. Marx himself would have changed radically after 1883 when he died, if he had seen what was coming, because he believed in the production technique. What was changing the world was technique of production and production relationship and the means of production, who owns them. So ultimately it was all related to technology, and Marx was a great believer of technology. But at that time, in 1883, there was hardly any technology which we can call as relevant today. And yet I find, very strangely, that those people who are mired in the ideologies of past about the Hinduism, about the caste structure, even in Maharashtra today, the predominant movement, the predominant television debate is about caste. It is not about development of Maharashtra. It is not about the environmental issues of Maharashtra. It is not about the development, economic and social development of Maharashtra. The predominant issue on all channels and all newspapers, on front pages, the editorials, the writers, the thinkers are talking about the caste aspect of great Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharashtra. It has nothing to do with what is happening. And therefore, what has remained, unfortunately, since Pivaru, is a caste, unfortunately. And the ideologies which were supposed to completely erase that caste from our life have slowly suffered a major setback. And that setback, recovering from that setback, has become a major task for the leftist movements, for the Marxist movement. They have to today fight the same caste which they did not really consider the major issue. In 1950, when India became republic, caste was supposed to be going away. Not only Nehruism, but Marxism, and there was nothing like strong right wing in India, notwithstanding Rajgopalachari. There's nothing like strong right wing, and to be a rightist meant, you know, it was like an abuse, even in the liberal circles. And today, almost suddenly, we find to be a left has become, in many parts of India, an abuse. So from right to left and left to right has changed, and mainly in last 20 years, that is after the collapse of Berlin Wall in 1989, when things began to change and even the leftists began to see reason in market. In 1991, when China became aggressively market-oriented, I don't think any communist who believed in 1950 in the communist ideology as such of yesterday would endorse whatever is happening in China today. And yet, that nostalgia towards China survives, and therefore, you will not find many comrades easily condemning or criticizing China, even when it sometimes deserves to be condemned, whether it's on workers' rights, on human rights, on environmental rights, and so on. Because they have that nostalgic feeling, not only towards China, but towards Russia, they are soft on it, and they do not take an ideological position, they take an emotional position.